Hey folks, welcome back to our continuing coverage of the GAMA 2018 trade show here in Reno, Nevada. I am here with Nolan from Deepwater Games, and they are the localized American distributor for Emperor S4. So he's going to have some titles from Emperor S4 that they are going to be making sure you can get your hands on here in America. So take it away.
Awesome. Thanks so much for having us on.
Oh, you're very welcome.
We appreciate your love of Emperor S4,
absolutely,
by the way.
That's great.
We share it too, obviously.
Yeah.
So I've got Sorcerer and Stones here for you guys today. This is a really beautiful, like most of their games, very like puzzle type game.
Yeah.
So players are playing as Taoists, and they are trying to reach enlightenment. And there's a lot of different puzzly elements that you can also add or remove from each game for varying levels of complexity. Like
that's
I've had
cool.
You know, people who are can cut away some of the more advanced stuff and play this. Mm-hmm. You can play this with like, you know, your 6-year-old or something like that, which we really enjoy that
that's
aspect
cool.
of it. So players are playing as Taoists trying to reach enlightenment, and you're going to be going through. Everybody has a deck of magic cards mm-hmm. that their Taoists can perform.
That's these guys, yes.
Right. And so on your turn, you're going to get to play a card, and you're going to use this card to manipulate these alchemy zones.
Oh.
And so these alchemy zones, on them, you'll see each one of us has a pawn on here, and you'll see that they have these, you know, big wooden cubes. These mm-hmm. are spirit stones. You're going to be collecting these spirit stones in order to craft artifacts and also move your spirit in the spirit realm.
Okay, cool.
To collect elemental runes.
Okay.
So on your turn, you're playing one or two cards to manipulate the board. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to arrange the spirit stones in certain ways so that when you activate the zone your character is on, you'll get to pick up those stones. And the way that works is, so I'm playing the blue player. One of the cards I can play is Fly. Mm-hmm. So Fly would let me move my Taoist to any other zone. So I'm going to move my Taoist over here. Now what happens when you activate an alchemy zone is that you pick up any stone that is touching a stone of another color on another zone. So when I activate this zone, I would get to pick up this green stone because it's adjacent
gotcha.
To another stone.
Okay, cool.
And what you're trying to do with the magic cards that you're playing is you're trying to arrange the boards and the stones
gotcha.
To get to pick up the most spirit stones.
Okay, cool.
So what's really cool about this is, so for example, if I had the yellow over here as well, when I activate the zone, I would also be able to pick up that yellow stone as well as the green stone. So you're trying to maximize how many stones you're able to pick up.
Gotcha.
Right. So when I activate this, I would pick up on my turn. I would pick up the
yellow and the green.
Yellow and the green, okay. And that would get added to my spirit stone board.
All right.
Then the next step is that based on the ones that I'm picking up, I would get to move my spirit in the spirit realm. So since I picked up a yellow and a green, I can move my spirit on yellow and green spaces over here. So I could move my spirit to that yellow space.
All right.
And when you end your movement next to a yellow rune. Or next to a rune, you get to pick it up, and that counts towards scoring at the end game.
And this is considered as being next to the yellow?
Yeah,
or is it next to the blue?
No, so what I meant was like next to one of the runes.
Oh, yeah, actual
yep.
runes.
And gotcha. Since I'm the blue player, I already have the blue rune.
Yeah.
So that's going to automatically count toward all the blue elements are already going to count
okay.
towards end game scoring for
Very
me.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Now, are you limited?
Yes.
You can't ever have more than 5.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yep. But you can afterwards spend your spirit stones on your turn to craft artifacts.
Okay.
And this is where more of the end game scoring comes in. So the artifacts are worth 3 points, right? But if I collected enough stones to craft one of these artifacts, I'd get to add it to my board. And then at the end of the game, depending on how many or which elemental runes I've picked up, mm-hmm. those runes would score bonus points for me.
Okay.
So if I've picked up the red and the green rune, in addition to already being the blue player, every artifact that I've crafted throughout the game that has a red, green, or blue element on it would be worth additional points.
Okay, so it's almost kind of like set collection then?
It is. There's a little element of set collection to it too.
Okay.
There's also these keystones that you get for completing various objectives or for picking up stones that are the same color as your player.
Okay.
And the objectives also kind of give you more advantages and things like that.
And those are like global?
Yeah, these are global. Yeah, global objectives that give you a reward. For example, like this one says, if you pick up 4 stones, if you activate your board and pick up all 4 stones, you get a bonus 4 keystones.
Oh,
and the
wow.
keystones are worth 1 point at the end of the game.
That's cool.
Yeah.
All right. So you have all these set out
yeah.
over here.
Yeah.
So are they going to be switching in and out?
Yep. So at the end of your turn, you're going to refill your board. So I would put this here and put that there, right?
Gotcha.
And you're refilling in a specific specific order, and then it would pass to you, and you would be then manipulating the board in order to collect as many spirit stones as possible. And there's cool stuff too, like there's the Quake card that lets you just pick up and move pieces.
Like this one right here?
Yep, exactly. Or there's the, yeah, there's the spin. You can spin your boards around to try and set up
So there's basically four. I'm looking, maybe there's four different cards, these four?
Yep, so there's, yeah, Quake, Spin, Shift, and Fly.
Okay, cool.
And the Shift lets you swap different different stones like that. Yep.
Right.
And there's one more rule to picking up stones, is I told you that the you can have the ones that are adjacent colored, right?
Right.
Well, however, if you also manage to get three in a row like this, these yellow technically aren't adjacent, but since they're in a line, when you activate your board, you would get this yellow stone because it's part of a line of stones.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So when you originally said that, I was like, they're not in a row. And then I'm looking straight at it.
Right,
I'm like,
yes.
Oh, that's what you meant.
Yep.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, so that's Sorcerer and Stones. It's really, I mean, it plays in like, 45, 60 minutes. And again, depending on what variants, like what you, because you can leave the objectives out, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can just work towards artifacts. You can leave out the spirit board if you want, depending on, the age level people that you're playing with. So you can really tune the complexity of it, which is something we love.
Okay, so this is Sorcerer and Stones.
Yes.
You had some other titles that you wanted to talk about, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
So we're bringing over Sorcerer and Stones, as well as Mystery of the Temples and Roundhouse.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, so I've got these here as well.
Let's go ahead and just set these up like this.
Yeah. So this is the next wave of games that we're bringing over from Emperor S4. And we are, so we're doing, English rulebook edits on all of them, extensive rulebook edits on all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And with Mystery of the Temples, actually, we're adding in colorblind components to make the game colorblind friendly.
Really?
Because that's been that's been one of the big things with Mystery of the Temples. It's a small box game, tons of strategy, tons of depth, but it's not super accessible to everybody.
Yeah.
So we're making it colorblind friendly. And
that's
then
cool.
These are all actually coming to Kickstarter at the end of the month on March 27th.
All right, and then Roundhouse is really kind of heavier fare, especially for considering Emperor S4.
Right.
This is more like a heavier Euro game style than a family game, which is really kind of their bread and butter.
Yes.
But this one is also a good game.
It is, and it's a fantastic. Honestly, I feel like as far as Euros go, it is a little bit more accessible and approachable for families, like even maybe more of a gateway Euro.
Mm.
It is heavy, but it's got it does have like a lot more simpler mechanics and components that make
There's just a lot to.
There is a lot.
Keep up.
Absolutely.
All right, cool. So now you mentioned about bringing these to Kickstarter.
Yes.
For distribution here in America, right? Okay, cool. And so what is your timeline there?
So we are targeting to have these released at Origins.
Mm-hmm.
We're moving really quickly on these, and they're going to be going straight into production because we are distributing them. And we're the ones bringing them to the States.
Right,
so we're putting them into production right away.
Cool.
We're not, banking on, it's not going to be like, we're not banking on Kickstarter to do it.
Understood.
Yep.
All right, so that's cool. Well, thank you so much, Nolan, for stopping by.
Thank you so much.
We certainly appreciate it. That's from Deepwater Games, and you can get your, be a little bit easier for you to get your hands on some Emperor S4 games from starting at Origins, so keep your eyes and ears open for that. Thanks for joining us, and we'll have some more Gamma videos shortly, so we'll see you on the flip side.